Good afternoon, everybody. I know we have just been allocated 30 minutes and we have approximately nine speakers. So I want to them at least tell their names and share what they have to say. But certainly it's quite fascinating to be here. I've been attending elets conferences, always been a pleasure of meeting some outstanding people from all across the country, sometime all across the world. It's a very important event, very important. Thanks for the government of Telangana, particularly Mr. Naveen Mittal for hosting us here in Hyderabad. Hyderabad always been considered to be the research hub for India, like Pune is considered as an Oxford of the East. Hyderabad, I'm sure, is considered to be the Silicon Valley to certain extent in terms of research. The kind of research and development which is happening in Hyderabad is unparalleled. So I'm glad that you all are able to come over here. I will go straight to the point here. So our topic for today is ensuring employability and entrepreneurship through education. There has been quite a significant development in the last 4 or 5 years. If you have seen, number of states have announced innovation startup policy, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Maharashtra, even Government of India, where everywhere in the state startup policy, it has been mentioned that entrepreneurship education is must. And now the innovation department and the higher education department are working together. And there has been provisions regarding transfer of credits. Number of institutions I have interacted with, they have set up the very specific entrepreneurship based curriculum. Even the school education nowadays, we are seeing increasingly, they are accepting entrepreneurship curriculum. So a very important factor for today. So my request to all the panelists, and there will be one common question. So my request is that we will go very, very quickly so that we can hear every one of us for at least twice. So first 1 minute, you can tell your name. Your affiliations are already there. So don't go too much about your where you come from and what you do, all the known people. So I'm sure everybody can Google you. So if you can straight go to the particular question about the theme, that how you can ensure entrepreneurship and employability, and are you doing something at your institution, and maybe what you want to do, what you want, a message you want to give. So maybe make it crisp, 1 minute. We will do one round and then we'll come back.
Good evening, and I'm from the PhD Institute of Management in Coimbatore. I'll first talk about entrepreneurship, because Coimbatore, where I come from, is a very entrepreneurial city and it's almost the DNA of people there. But as an institute, we focus a lot on entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is kind almost a training there. We have a business plan which is given to our MBA students as a value add. As part of the business plan, we have a whole lot of talk series that we do. We promote a competition that we do with the University of Toledo in the US, where we have people coming in from Toledo, and then we have this competition where students present their business plan, and the first three winners are given a decent amount of money where they're allowed to kind of use it as a seed for the idea that they have. We do a lot of ideation workshops. And we also very proud that somewhere down the line, at least 50% of our students turn out to be entrepreneurs. Those who just move out of the campus, we have about 8 to 10% who really don't look for jobs, and they all get into entrepreneurship. What is also interesting to see in our campus is we are now seeing a lot of social entrepreneurship coming up. And that's about entrepreneurship. I'll talk briefly about what we do towards employability. Employability, we start first with our curriculum. Our curriculum is, at the MBA level, is classified as core, elective, and value add. Value add courses are something that we focus a lot on. And our value add courses have something to do with creativity, innovation, design thinking, emotional intelligence. Those are the different kind of courses that we offer, and the student has a choice. We have about 8 such courses that we offer, and the student has a choice to pick any 4 of those courses. We also have what is called outbound training center where we believe, yeah, it's one thing to talk about leadership, team building, so on and so forth, but then it's a totally different thing to give them a hands-on on what it is to be a leader, what it is to be a team player. And so we have these outbound training centers where students are asked, have to spend 40 hours in the first year working out different things just to experience what they feel to be a leader and how it feels to be, sorry, to be a team player. Then in the second year, we again build on the same skills and try and kind of give them a little more of those inputs. In terms of the teaching that we do in our campus, we do not, there is a syllabus that we have, but then we make sure that we do not teach the entire 100%. So we do about 70 to 75% of the syllabus, and the rest of it is either allowed to self-learn, or it is done, or it's facilitated with the help of what we call seminars and experiences and so on. There's a lot of experiential learning. There's a lot of, projects that they have to do. Projects, internship is one thing, but almost every single course that they have to undergo, there is one project associated. So they kind of have to work with the industry, have to pick up information with the industry. They are forced to read, and they have no other choice. They have to do it. So in our minds, we're thinking probably they understand what's happening like, what's happening with Jack Ma, or what's happening with Google, or what's happening with Apple, is something they have to read because their assignments are based on that.
And Dr. Vijaya, I will come back to you. Sure. I will ask you very specific questions since you are from JNTU. JNTU is one of the most known technical institutions in the country, and you have produced many IT entrepreneurs. So how you are imbibing entrepreneurial training in technical engineers?
Yeah, there are two, three aspects related to that. First is what we actually believe in is the psychometric analysis of the students. The moment when they join the engineering first, the students should know what are their strengths and what are their weaknesses and where you can venture into. What are your capabilities through that with which you can be able to build your career? That's one thing. And second thing is about, as Madam has rightly mentioned, added to that, we are focusing more and more on entrepreneur skills, and JNTU has recently established JNTU Hyderabad Innovation Hub, J Hub, and where Madam is also one of the members, and we have Industry Advisory Council, and many of the industrial heads and industrial association heads are on the board, and we are taking their, you know, their advice, their, you know, continuous pursuance, how as to how we can improve the skill set of the students particularly. And we have also taken up programs like Excite, which is a 6 to 8 week program, which is done during the summer vacation. And 40 to 50 college students send their students for the complete product life cycle. They start up with some idea, and after 6 weeks, they end up with a product. And industrial are the experts from industry come as mentors, share their expertise, and they guide them, they mentor them, so from which they will be able to really understand what exactly is happening in the industry. So of course we have started with it, with a small number, but it has to scale up, and we are working in those lines. That's one thing. And second important aspect, which I personally feel, is that, you know, I feel that, you know, most of us, at least 75% of us, have come with a humble background, in spite of, you know, lot of resource crunch. But if you look at the kind of resources that we have, so where is the lacuna? If you really look at from that perspective, I personally feel that there is a will that is required. We have to create a student, among the students, we have to inspire them, we have to make them passionate about their career, and, you know, skill and will. The will always dominates the skill. So we have to inspire in such a way that students develop their imaginative skills, and they create their own role models with which they'll get inspired. In the process, we are also involving our alumni. Alumni are the one of the important catalysts to see that, you know, students can understand where they can grow or what is their, you know, career plan. So that way we have already created alumni lecture series with which, you know, entrepreneurs, technical experts, social engineers, they are invited and they share their expertise.
Skill and will, I think this is a very apt question for Srinivas. Shrikant. Shrikant is with NASSCOM, and NASSCOM has been instrumental in promoting entrepreneurship for last 2-3 decades. Some of the most known IT entrepreneurs which we celebrate, we from Narayan Murthy to Azim Premji to Shiv Nadar, and you name it, and even today we are speaking Satya Nadella from Hyderabad, all somehow associated with NASSCOM. So are you, I'm aware about certain programs with NASSCOM, but can you highlight some of the programs which is useful for education institution?
Sure, thank you. So good evening again. I think from NASSCOM perspective, I think one of the key things or the key activities that we have been working on for the last few years has been on promoting and nurturing entrepreneurship. Because all said and done, if you look at the IT/ITES industry, which NASSCOM represents, has been a predominantly services industry, an industry which has been serving the needs of the customer organizations, if I can call it so. So it's time that we create the next large company which will give services opportunity to others. And if we have to do that, we need to create a product company, we need to create companies which can eventually become large employers, and hence the entrepreneurship bug. Now, if you really look at the way it has kind of moved, we started this whole 10,000 startup initiative. It's been about a little over three and a half years. We've been making reasonably good progress in terms of incubation, in terms of acceleration, in terms of mentoring, seeing how do we take these startups, take them up the value chain, give them a GTM strategy, and so on. But I think it's very important to recognize that all this is happening because I think we are in some fantastic times as we all live. Because today, the entire digital disruption that's happening around us, the opportunity that is available is probably the key reason or the key ingredient that people are even looking at entrepreneurship as an opportunity. And I think beyond the startup initiative that we do, I think a couple of other things that which Nikhil mentioned talked about, I think, we are also setting up centers of excellence in things like IoT, in things like data science and artificial intelligence, setting up centers of excellence in cybersecurity. So these are all ways and means to ensure that we kind of, you know, nurture the talent, pull up that latent talent, bring them up the value chain, and see how they can create products of the future.
Thank you. Dr. Shanta, you are from T-Hub. Prime Minister himself said that T-Hub is the best and the largest incubator in the country. I don't think that you have this Paytm movement once, which always now has been similar. So now I believe with a new government, of course, the same party, but the new government is always new. So new government coming in, what's the plan for the T-Hubs?
Yeah, good question. Good afternoon, everyone. So it's not just India's largest. Now we will be calling ourselves as world's leading, you know, innovation center, incubation center, powering innovation. So having said that, we are 3 years old. We focus on how to help startups scale up. So we are not, you know, kind of, we pivoted a lot. Like the past 3 years, what we said is, let's see what works for us, like compared to other 40 incubators which are located in the state, and also like the other incubators which are based out of India and also globally. Then we identified, like, how about we select startups which are matured and help them scale up further. Scaling for us comes in two folds. One is finding startups customers, and also the second piece is helping them raise funds. So EduTech, which is apparently not our primary focus, having said that, we focus on seven verticals, which are like, you know, again, why we chose those seven verticals, because the amount of, you know, innovation happening in those seven verticals is like, you know, lot more. And we thought, like, being the leader in this space, we should kind of cater to the needs of these startups, and then we kind of curated startups, build the community of all the startups. 3 years ago, if you see the startup ecosystem, not much was happening in this space. But now you can see, you know, 2,000 plus startups, you know, which are like, you know, kind of trying to scale up. And also a lot of, you know, investors, VCs, angel investors are located based out of Hyderabad. So the whole ecosystem evolved in the last 3 years. And it's a humbling moment to say, like, T-Hub kind of, like, you know, did a lot in, like, you know, moving this, you know, the ecosystem, nurturing this ecosystem. So having said that, like, the seven verticals we are primarily focusing, but we get to see good startups coming in EduTech. So when it comes to innovation, we just don't only look into EduTech, we look into the whole education as a sector, because it's a different animal altogether. You cannot compare the other sectors with education sector. Why I'm saying that is the return on investments. this is a patient capital sector. You know, if an investor is coming forward and, you know, kind of investing in edutech startups, that investor is always looking at, like, when am I getting my returns? So it's going to take some time to move the edutech space. Having said that, like, we have decent number of edutech startups which are working and which are solving the problems at every stage of education and also the student life. So apparently, this weekend I was in my hometown and I was hearing from the principal of an engineering college. He's like, we are bringing really good industries to campus for campus selections, but we don't know what's happening. The students are not taking up those jobs. I said, like, this is a grave problem we have, right? Then I asked him immediately, are you kind of like, you know, assessing what is going wrong? Like, you know, what are you kind of trying to do to overcome this problem? They said, like, we are still in that process. They said, like, you cannot do this for the past 3 years or 4 years, right? Right away, I came back and I kind of went through my edutech startups and I found a startup that is addressing the same niche problem what this college is facing. Especially, like, you know, this startup is putting together a data analytics based platform which is pulling the student crowd and helping them to upskill themselves and also pulling the corporates which are, like, you know, asking for those set of skill set in the students. So he's kind of like managing the corporates and also the students to kind of, like, you know, upskill themselves and go present to these corporates and make sure, like, the bridge is, you know, established. So this is a gateway he's creating. So then I connected that startup immediately to the college saying, like, this is an opportunity for you to kind of, you know, embark in partnership with particular startup. So I have my own, like, you know, goal by doing this connection because I'm solving the problem of the engineering college, but at the same time, I'm helping my startup to scale up. So eventually, like, once he demos this product to this particular college, I can connect him to other colleges, right? I'm solving two things at one shot. So that is what I look when it comes to startup ecosystem and how we are enabling technology to kind of bring the innovation and embrace the change.
Thank you. I think with the current change, your new CEO has joined, Ravi Narayan, very capable guy from Microsoft who has managed a global startup. So best of luck to Ravi and your team for making this for next 5 years the best for Hyderabad and Telangana and for India. Dr. Mishra, you have been the part of CSIR. Again, CSIR has produced some of the most brilliant drugs in the country. So can you please highlight, and particularly I'm pretty impressed about the DBT schemes, Virag schemes, promoting entrepreneurship from the grassroots level. So if you can kindly highlight the work that we've been doing in cellular and micro molecular energy and how you are connected, how you are promoting entrepreneurship with your center.
Thank you. So CCMB is primarily the place where we provide world-class infrastructure for basic research to do basic biology. And we have been producing PhD students, 40% of them take the leadership position within the country, 40% go abroad, settle there, and about 20% go into entrepreneurship, do various kinds of industry, they have their own business. We, couple of years back, we decided to take a strategic decision and decided to host companies or startups within CCMB. And we have done that reasonably well now. We have now 2 years of experience. We are the first government organization in healthcare who got the Atal Incubation Center, which is doing very well. Now we have around 16 companies that are being, startups that are being incubated, and we provide them world-class infrastructure, other kinds of support, advice from experts, and our companies have already started now graduating in a really big way. Now the idea here is that students who are the brightest that we select for our program, we want them to get into entrepreneurship, be job producers, and be entrepreneurs rather than staying only to one line of research, which is to go to IIT or go to ICERS or go to CSIR labs and run labs, or go abroad and do postdoc and work for some universities. So this is our focus now, to divert our students towards the social needs of our country, because that is the challenge, that is innovation, that is where the innovation is required to address. Nobody else is going to solve our problem. It is we who have to solve. And biology stands today in a very, very peculiar and very advantageous position, Because now after 5 years, maybe not 5 years, maybe 10 years, the way you will be treated for any disease is going to be very different. It will depend upon what kind of genetic makeup you have, what kind of susceptibility you have. If you are XYZ, you will be given a specific drug in a specific quantity, and not everybody gets a 650 mg paracetamol when you have fever. That is not the way we are going to be treated tomorrow, and that is technology that is emerging, and it requires, first, it offers the tremendous business opportunity, and at the same time, it will be cost saving from the healthcare system. So all the governments are very, very keen to adopt to it. You may have heard even Prime Minister talking about precision medicine, personalized medicine, and that is where a laboratory like CCMB is aiming to make contribution and make a big impact, which is to attract the best of the society, the best students to come and learn the technology, become entrepreneur, and go and express themselves and change the society and meet the societal needs that we have today. So that's our effort.
I think, frankly speaking, as an independent academic, I can say the most impressive department in promoting science and technology is DST. Phenomenal job done in the last few years, and the kind of independence, the kind of program which has been now supported by DST are fantastic.
I agree with you. So many of our programs, many of our facilities are supported by DST. CSIR, we are a CSIR lab, yeah. But 50% of our research expenditure, if you count on still, it comes from DST and DST.
CSR is still part of DST?
No, CSR is an independent society. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But it has its own lab, but we get the grants from DBT and DST. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I'll go to Dr. Mona Khare, who is Professor and Head for National University of Educational Planning and Administration. So ma'am, how you are promoting entrepreneurship?
Well, I think a question which has been asked to a wrong person, because coming from the government, I think I bring to fore the concerns of a policy analyst when it comes to this issue of employability and entrepreneurship. Let me just begin with saying, when we come to these kinds of events, we are really highly impressed with the presentations that are made by several of the institutions on the kind of initiatives that are taken by them. But then when we look at the figures that are quoted by organizations like NASSCOM or maybe the India Employability Report, when they say that not even 25% of our engineering graduates are employable, and this number is even lesser for other graduates, that is merely 10%, it really sets us thinking. And therefore, we from the government, we embarked on a national level study to find out what exactly is going wrong and where. And I think the whole issue or challenge is on the other side, that is those 85% of our public institutions where the problem lies more. And from the study that we conducted, we were able to identify rather three kinds of gap, which I would want to share at this platform. And I'm sure if we are able to plug in these three gaps, not only will we be able to improve the employability quotient of our graduates, but also make them more risk lovers, which is one of the important traits for anybody to start a business of his or her own. And these three gaps, if I have to begin with, are awareness gap, perspective gap, and then comes the skill gap. So how we define the awareness gap is, in order to be either a good prospective employee or an entrepreneur, you need to be able to look into the future, what the future demands are going to be. And as far as the labor management information system in the country is concerned, it is currently very weak. And therefore, there is a huge gap that remains between the academia and the industry experts on what are the kind of skills or what are the kind of trades that would be required in future, what are the kind of trades that are going to grow in future. That's the kind of awareness gap that lies. Perception gap. Certainly, you will all agree that there are several stakeholders to this entire skill building campus of the student body. We cannot just put the entire responsibility on the higher education institutions. The industry is responsible, the NGO sector is responsible, the society at large is responsible. We are also targeting global citizenship and global awareness, so of course internationalization is equally important. Now looking at this entire gamut of stakeholders, then what we find is the very idea about what an employable individual should be varies drastically. And that again becomes a huge gap. And how do we then fill that gap up? Then of course, coming to the skills gap, and I don't think I need to talk too much on that, but when we look at employability skill gaps, we are looking at three elements, three major elements: knowledge, aptitude, attitude, and then skills. And you all would know that India, from its golden time of higher education, if I can call that, we have been a very, very knowledge-centric higher education system. It is only recently that even in the government, we have now realized the importance of skill-based education, and therefore the government has embarked on a large-scale vocationalization of higher education program. But the biggest challenge that lies here is possibly it becomes a little easier for technological and professional institutions to get into these kind of activities of tapping the industry, doing an MOU with the industry, or maybe being able to create those kinds of lab structures or on-job training programs, etc., etc. But when it comes to that larger mass of our general academic streams, it becomes extremely challenging. Also, when we are looking at vocationalization of higher education, both at the undergrad as well as at the postgrad level, although the scheme says that whatever course is launched by any institution has to have some kind of a local flavor to it. And therefore, before even identifying the kind of vocational course that the institution would like to launch, it is important for it to do some kind of a basic local survey to know what course would run and sustain for a longer time. So again, I put a big question mark on the sustainability of any of these initiatives which are taken up. From our past experiences, and also from the surveys, what we have found is most of these initiatives are individual-centric. And we want that they become more institutionalized. They have to be more systemized so that they are institutionalized rather than that they remain individual initiatives. I think I'll stop here. Yeah,
thank you
next
very much.
Round. Thank you.
There is one certain, I think, most of the speakers talking about employability, but there are a lot of surveys which says McKinsey report and some of the reports which were spoken about. Employability is 83%. Bitcoin is one institution which has taken up the employability. So my question of employability will be there to you. But before that, I don't know anybody is aware about the similar survey being done for Western countries. It will be very useful to see the comparison between the more advanced nation like US or UK, where education is higher, and then India. And employability changes over a period of time, of course. In 2-3 years, as soon as the candidate joins the industry, the employability prospects and the ratio dramatically changes. So it will be just a useful understanding. But coming back to Mitcon is started as an employability institution now. Certainly, it's a force to reckon with, in particularly in Maharashtra. So please tell us more about how you are ensuring employability and entrepreneurship at the same time.
Yeah. Very good afternoon. I'm Dr. Ganesh Rao, Director of Mitcon Institute of Management and also the trustee of the foundation. Mitcon was originally a consulting organization set up in the early 80s to work on the feasibility of the SME sector. Okay. Now, coming back to the question that is put up about the surveys, and about the buzzword that is going on today, employability and entrepreneurship. 10 years back, this statement of employability became very famous. 30 years back, it was not there. It was there, but it did not surface. What happened that this issue became so big? Leading organizations have come up with various figures, 20%, 25% is employable. The bigger the organization, the lower is the figure. Then they say 15% and they say 10%. You know what happens when we talk this way about the education sector is the students start losing the confidence. The students are the biggest energy and the resource of the country. And when the resource like a student gets into a dilemma, we are wasting a lot of potential. We are making our generation worried about it. Just a small example, if we say that in a particular hospital, only 20% of them come out healthy. Now that's a big statement. Now are you going to blame the patient or the doctor? I would say both. If you say education, employability is a problem, are you going to blame both? Yes, both. But who is going to change? Who is going to lead the change? Is it a doctor? Is it a professor? So my request to all of you is, nations have developed in the past, over the past 100 years, 200 years, it is due to the fundamental growth in the education sector. We loosely and popularly call development as a lot of bridges coming up, a lot of conveniences, airports coming up. These are conveniences. Development only happens if there is a sustainable income and production generated. So that only happens if there is employment, if there is employability. So I would request that we come out to an action plan and get an assessment board. If we go back to our colleges, our academicians, they are the people who can turn it around. And there are many people who are doing so. Learned people here, many of them are doing it. In this hall, there are perhaps so many experienced people, much experienced than me, and people outside who are so very experienced. We can turn it all, but we need to resolve. Otherwise, we create a depression in the sector and start wondering why the students are not coming. And then we give scholarships, fee waivers. It's not needed. It's not really needed. If the faculty, of course, each of the faculty, of course, are in the pursuit of becoming an assistant professor, then an associate professor, then a professor. He's in his pursuit of his PhD. He's into research. But if you're going to do what the candidate wants, what does the candidate want? Today he has got knowledge. He's got a bit of skills, not much. Okay, we say skill gap, but it is actually a skill mismatch. It's not a gap. And the third aspect is attitude. Now, attitude is 70% of the success of any individual. If you take everybody at an equal level of knowledge and skills, it's attitude which is going to determine the success. So if all the professors, see, for example, if you go to any college and you say, if the placement salesperson says that you have been placed in Delhi and you should report from the 1st of March, he says, no, I want it nearer home. Now, if I tell the professor, you're transferred to a suburb a bit far away from Hyderabad city, he will say, it's going to be very difficult, sir. How do you expect me to come? So if we are not going to be flexible, do not expect the student to be flexible. So I would like a lot of entrepreneurial zeal to be in the faculty members to look introspect and see how we can be more inspiring to the students rather than being more worrying. Don't forget all these figures and statistics and start internally assessing yourself, what you can give. Jobs are going to come, jobs are going to go. They're going to be futuristic jobs, they're going to be past jobs. We have to keep on upgrading the skills and lessening the mismatch. And how does entrepreneurship come? Entrepreneurship comes if we all become more enterprising. 9 to 5, sorry, that's a job. 9 to 6, 9 to 8, 9 to 9, and then pushing our way forward as faculties, as assisting students. Look at us, most of us sitting here belong to the mid-tier segment. That's a segment, accept them. We as faculty members, we as teachers need to accept the segment as they are. Once we accept them, we will own them. We will have to adopt them. And then you will see everything vanishing. When we go home, we adopt our children, we take care of children. Similarly, we just start adopting the students. Believe me, it's all, a lot of things are in the mind. And I think a lot of course is there. A lot of technology can play. A lot of upgradation, the curriculum is required. But if you ask me, there are two things. One is the hardware, there's the buildings. I think that those are there in enough numbers. The other is the software. The software is the curriculum and the faculty. These two can only change. And this is where the leadership in education is required. And I would request all of us that we resolve to rise as leaders and not as warriors.
Thank you very much, sir. Dr. Ramana. Dr. Ramana, you are the vice chairman for Telangana State Council for Higher Education. So you have Hyderabad and rest of Telangana. So my first question is, how do you bridge the gap? Hyderabad is, in the beginning of the session, I said, a jewel in the crown for the entire country. So the finest research institution, higher education institution, we receive students from all over the world. We have institutions like ISB and IIIT and JNTU. But what's your plan for the rest of Telangana? How you want to replicate another Hyderabad in Telangana? I'm sure Honorable CM would be delighted to hear your thoughts.
Thank you. Thank you very much. First of all, I must say that, I mean, just give you a background of what we do. We plan for the academic programs and we coordinate with universities. We also work with the national bodies like UGC, IICT. And more importantly, in the last few years, we have been thinking of how do we really take higher education beyond Hyderabad. Around 4.5 years back, just to give you a background, I wrote a piece in Times of India, which said, time to think beyond Hyderabad. So a lot of people called me and said, what are you saying? And I said, what you meant now? So as a matter of continuity to that, beyond Hyderabad, just 100 kilometers away, the landscape is totally different. The educational systems are different. The manpower is different. The staffing pattern is different. The infrastructure is different. But what you find very unique in Telangana is, one, it's a small state. Two, it's easily accessible across districts. So it's not a difficult thing to really replicate the so-called Hyderabad model. Because if you really look at an institution, if you look at IITs, or if you look at many of these real hybrid institutions in the US or even in India, you find that they have grown from small places. Talk about BITS Pilani. I mean, if you really look at it. So what we are trying to do with the help of Commissioner of Technical and Collegiate Education, Mr. Navin Mittal, and of course some other institutions, and also the national bodies. You have real good institutions outside of Hyderabad also. RGVKT is a classic model, where you have students taken after 10th, and in 6 years they become entrepreneurs and world-class engineers. So that's one part of it. Two, the second challenge lies, I mean, quickly, because you said that most of the people sitting here, including me, used to think 10 years back that innovation happens only in metropolitan cities where there is connectivity and where there is good roads, etc. Unfortunately, most of the innovations are taking place in the rural setting. So if we can provide plug and play connectivity and whatever bandwidth we need, I think, you know, the rural India has got a lot of potential. What would happen is Hyderabad would be the hub and districts would become the spoke. So we will be the hub and spoke model. And I'm very confident in the next 1-3 years, you will find one or two IIMs. One IIM is going to come, ISER is going to come, a School of Planning and Architecture, and all of them will be outside of Hyderabad, except IIM, I think, you know, because we are recommended that it should be in Hyderabad, because you don't get good faculty if you locate any good institution, even 100 kilometers away. What Ganesh said is right. But we are trying to lure people to get into this reality that they have to move out of Hyderabad, and they have to also have and also the triple R. I can go on and on what we can do to decongest Hyderabad, but good question. You know, we need to decongest Hyderabad. We need to take away a lot of institutions to the rural setting. Thank you.
So I think it's been 5 years since you wrote a Times of India piece. You should write a new piece replicating Hyderabad. I think it will become, I like this term about Hyderabad model. So how even other states can replicate this model Hyderabad. Thank you very much. So very quickly, I will open up. Maybe Sudhir is already pointing out that time is up. So we have time for one or two questions if have anybody. Otherwise, you can clap for us. Yes, please. Yes, sir. I can hear you. You can ask.
Hello. Excuse me, Chairman, sir. I've been a part of this discussion, and we all have been part of this. Since morning, we are discussing employability. Okay. But if you look at the rate of employment, okay, does that match this statistics of employability, which varies from organization to organization, survey to survey? So does that mean a lot of misfits are getting employed? I mean, what is happening? Or is it an ideal state of employability? Are we taking too many parameter, too rigid parameter? Because it cannot be so bad, like 10%, 20% employability. So that should match with the unemployment there.
I absolutely agree with you. This survey is very flawed.
Where did we get this rigid classification of employability.
I agree with you. The surveys are flawed because 17% employability, if you like, let's say a million graduates are graduating, so that means 170,000 people are employable, and you pick up, he can throw some numbers from Cognizant and TCS. TCS is hiring 25,000 this year, Infosys is hiring 30,000 a year. So how do you, so you are hiring people like who are not. So of course, employability versus productivity is one thing, and of course you learn the tricks of the trade as you go into the company, not every company is doing, and lot of these capabilities are learned as you go along.
Also, our experience proves that we employ them and then find them they are not employable. So we make them employable over a period of time, right? So getting a job is different from employability. We are not looking strictly, we are not putting that under scanner, employability. We are looking for a candidate, we employ them, and then we realize he is not employable, even then he gets away with that.
See,
and we
get to pay. If you look at 30 years back, all of us, you know, I graduated 30 years back as an MBA, so we were more humble then. Whatever job was given was done by us, and the boss would scold us, we would put our heads down, and we slowly learned, and we also. But the current generation, it's all ready-made. I want results today. So we want ready to use. So in that generation, what happens is, suddenly this new buzzword of employability has created a kind of a fear. I would request all of us that we abstain from using these figures of 20% and...
So yeah, let me clarify, I mean, from a NASCOM perspective and IT, BPM industry perspective. See, I mean, let me first of all clarify saying that the situation is not as dismal as we all talk about. It is not dismal. Let me give you that hope. The point, what I want to say here is, see, we are in a very paradox kind of a situation. On the one side, we say there are people who are passing out who are not getting jobs. On the other side, we have organizations who are saying we are not getting the right set of people. What is the problem? The problem is there is no match. We are comparing probably apples and oranges. The question is, does the academia know what the industry is willing to hire, what the industry needs to hire, what they want today? If we are training somebody who would have been employable 5 years ago, then I think what we're doing at academia level is not right. Are we today, the need of the industry is getting people ready who are high with higher digital capability. The capability of digital learning must be high. They should have an ability to continuously learn, relearn, unlearn and relearn all the time. As long as you are people of that nature, the industry will be willing to take. If that is not the case, yes, they're going to be unhirable, and that's the reality of life. The second reason why this may be happening, and I want to go out of this room unhurt if I'm going to make this statement with so many people from the academia world. I think it's important to also, the academia should be updated. It's very important. See, is the academia today updated and teaching what is current is very, very important to know. If we are teaching something what was to be taught 10 years ago, which is not updated, obviously, your students are not ready, the industry is not going to take them. It's very important. And today we are in a situation where things are changing by the day, by the minute. And it's important to be recognizing this piece and updating the curriculum. As long as we can do that, I don't think we'll have this problem.
Mittal sir, want to make a comment?
The point I wanted to make is again, basically taking off from where Dr. Ashok was saying, is that some of these reports will be typically parameter based. I mean, we had a look at something like this with the help of Telangana State Council of Higher Education for our university and college rankings, where there are parameters on Times ranking or QS ranking, and we realized that why we are not figuring in the top 100 is basically because of two, three parameters. One is internationalization of students, internationalization of faculty, and also research publication, which is publications are happening, but then it is not figuring in references elsewhere. So we have a very concrete set of three issues which we are going to work on to improve our in institutional rankings. So similarly, I think if you have to really look at this number, we probably need to look at what are the parameters which are being judged, and then we have a ready-made recipe for improving. But of course, things don't end there, because I think we are talking of it mainly from the software industry kind of a point of view, but there are a whole lot of other things where things are not so objective. I mean, and I fully agree with what Mr. Ganesh Rao said. it's so many sets of things that you can't pinpoint 1, 2, 3, 4.
And I think one survey is important to be done with employability, the teachability of the institution and the teachers. Whether as a teacher, we all are learning enough to teach to the students.
Another point is India, if you see like 10 years ago, it's all like GICs, right? Now we are like, you know, shifting towards, you know, the product development powerhouses, right? And more towards enterprising, right? So maybe we are assessing more like, you know, based on the criterion from the last 10 years or so. But if I see like, you know, we conduct hackathons, I'm sure like J-Hub conducts tons of hackathons. We see like good talent coming out. Maybe they are not good at, you know, the academia, you know, probably like curriculum wise, but out of the think, box thinking and go-getters, risk takers, that is where the assessment is happening currently. When you have to hire a new talent, now people are not adapting to the conventional way of like assessing the students, like GPAs, whatever, like, you know, the resume, like, you know, what kind of experience they have. Apart from that, they are being assessed on other factors. So we will see a shift. Those numbers are grave as if we are looking right now, but probably like a year or 2 years later, the whole shift will happen in that space.
I think we'll take both the questions together because we will make it last question. Now, Sudhir is with both hands, he is waving at me. So,
so yes, this is a question to NASSCOM and also T-Hub. You are aware about the new technologies which are coming, also publicized. And what our chairman has said is, do you have the people to teach them? So scarcity of teachers who can understand and then teach is very less. So what has to be done to make our students better? First make teachers better. So I request NASSCOM to take a little more with kindness that they have to organize the faculty development programs in a new area. So that teachers who are out of that particular training program will be able to teach generations of students. So this has to be taken up by NASSCOM and other organizations, and more so for other industries.
Thank you. Also. Thank you very much, sir.
Sure, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
The last comment, please.
Yeah, very good evening. Well, I would rather express it more of a concern than a question. We are looking at employability, entrepreneurship, etc. But my fundamental question is, we started off with the objective of a nation's growth and development through human resource and through higher education. Obviously, when we talk about nation, we are looking at our higher education sector to move in the right direction. I hope this back
No, I absolutely agree. I'll answer one question of yours regarding the policy. The budget allocation for higher education, I think, is never enough. Last statistics, what we have seen is India is adding 50,000 kids a day. So that means we need a JNTU a day, every day, just to teach those kids. Forget about taking them to the next level and entrepreneurship is. So it's a very challenging task. So I think it's a number of policymakers are sitting, I'm sure. It's just also the civic duty of a person to look at that, how we can improve, how we can put a tap on our population and increase the education infrastructure, other infrastructures. That's one part. Right. So with this, we would like to end here. Thank you very much, and thank for being patient for hearing. And now you can clap for us. So.
I would request all the esteemed speakers to stay back. I would request our program chair, Mr. Naveen Mittal, Commissioner for Collegiate and Technical Education Department, to please present speak on mementos to our esteemed speakers here. I would say this was the session that was most looked after. Just to give you the background, before building up this particular conclave, we had several meetings with the colleges which are part of this conclave now. PG Vijaya, Director, PSG Institute of Management, Tamil Nadu. And we have the Pro Vice Chancellor from JNTU, Mr. Govardhan. Srikant Srinivasan from NASCOM. Dr. Shanta from T-Hub. And we have the director for CCMB, Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology. Dr. Nikhil Agarwal, Vice Chairman, Milab, Government of Maharashtra and Senior Advisor for FICCI BizNet. Mona Khare, Professor and Head, National University of Educational Planning and Administration, Government of India. Dr. Ganesh Rao, Director, MITCON Institute of Management, Maharashtra. Professor V. Venkataramana, Vice Chairman, Telangana State Council of Higher Education. I would request all the esteemed speakers to pose for a picture. Thank you everyone.